First part today, we will talk about introduction to chemical bonding and also take up classical theories of chemical bonding. The session is planned as follows. That is, to begin with, we will try to introduce the topic, what exactly we mean by chemical bonding, why of chemical bonding and things like that. Thereafter, we will talk about some historical thoughts which people have visualized about chemical bonding. That means, how did people think about chemical bond in the historical times? Thereafter, we will talk about the classical theories of chemical bonding. I'm sure that you know that there are two kinds of theories of chemical bonding, the classical theories and the quantum mechanical theories. So today's session, we will focus on to the classical theories. Therein, we are going to talk about two theories there. The first one will be the Cossel's theory, which concerns ionic bonding. And the second will be the Lewis theory regarding covalent bonding there. After doing all this, we will try to sum up what we do in today's session. Okay, let's get going. Let's get going and see that basically, if you look at the hydrogen, which comprises about 90% of the universe, that exists as hydrogen, H2, molecular hydrogen. Because only probably in sun and other stars, you can think of hydrogen in the atomic form over there. In this universe, primarily hydrogen will be existing as hydrogen molecules there. Similarly, if you look at our atmosphere, we find that the nitrogen and oxygen, which constitute about 99% of our atmosphere, they are all molecules that we know pretty well. If you go further down, if you look into the Earth crust, that means the composition, the constituents which make Earth crust, you find that 90% or 99% of that happen to be the compounds there. What does it mean? It means that matter exists primarily in the combined state. That's very, very important. That means we know that there are atoms, there are molecules and things like that, but primarily matter as it exists, that happens to be in the combined state. That is the molecular or the compound formation part of it. Now, if that be so, then the question comes is, that why does it happen? Why can't the atoms stay alone? Why do they have to combine together to give molecules? That's one question we have to ask ourselves. The second question we can put forth is that what are the forces that bind the atom together? Okay, first thing is, firstly, why do they bind? Number one. Number two, if they bind, then what are the kind of forces that hold them together? Then the third question which probably you can ask is that what are different ways in which the atoms can combine? Is there only one way of doing it, or there are many more ways of doing it? So all that will be, that actually these three questions primarily form the basis or the domain of so-called chemical bonding. Okay, so I'm sure that you're with me on this, that matter exists primarily in the combined state, and that if that be so, there are certain questions which lead us to the domain of chemical bonding. Okay, let's go ahead and look at some historical thoughts on chemical bonding. It will be very interesting to note that initially people thought that atoms have some kind of hooks and which the two can latch together to each other to form molecules. That means atoms can combine in terms of some kind of projections which are there on the atoms. They will latch to each other and they form a molecule, or they just combine there. Other thought people had was that probably atoms are like the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle. I'm sure that you know about the jigsaw puzzles there. So there's one piece there, another piece there, the two fix into one another and form a combined state over there. That's another thought people had about it. Yet another way people thought of the kind of means of chemical bonding or means of combination of atoms there, they thought probably atoms have got some kind of affinities. Like we human beings have affinities. I may like someone, I may not like someone else. I may have affinity for a given person, may not have affinity for some other. Similarly, people thought maybe even atoms have some kind of affinities. So the atoms which have affinity for each other will combine. The ones which do not have affinity for each other will not combine. That was another thought which was there on this. Yet another way people looked into was that probably there's some kind of an attractive force similar to what we have in the case of gravity, because every two bodies are attracted by some kind of a gravitational force there. Or you can think of magnetism or electricity. So some kind of this kind of force is available there which puts the two atoms together to make them combine there. So they were the initial thoughts. But that is, as it stands, that's the history part of it. That's how people thought of it initially. But now we know it much more about how do atoms combine and why do atoms combine. We will talk about all that in this series of lectures there. But for right now, let's ask, let's try to share one more important historical development that happened in about 1819, wherein Berzelius, it's a very famous scientist there, who speculated that there is some kind of an electrostatic interaction between the atoms. That means the two atoms are there, one happens to be positively charged, one happens to be negatively charged, and the two interact in an electrostatic way. And that in fact actually laid the foundation of what we now call it as ionic bond formation, or some kind of a clue to the nature of bonding in case of ionic substances. That is what Berzelius did in 1819. Thereafter, if now look at, if you try to visualize what exactly is a chemical bond, for that let's try to visualize. Let's take up, think of two atoms there, say atom 1 and atom 2. And let's say the two are very far from each other, such that there is no interaction between the two. That means the interaction energy between the two happens to be, you can take it to be zero. As the atom come closer and closer, as they come closer and closer, there's some kind of interaction comes into play. Since the interaction comes into play, there's some kind of attractive influence comes in. And that attractive influence goes on increasing as they come closer and closer. If you look into this graph, the two atoms are far apart, the interaction energy is very, very minimal, or so close to zero. As they come closer and closer, and this is basically internuclear distance, interatomic distance or internuclear distance also is fine. So when they come closer and closer, the energy goes on decreasing. And at a certain internuclear distance, the energy happens to be minimal. That we know is called as a chemical, that's a bond length, so to say. So essentially, what we see from here, what we understand from this graph is that a chemical bond can be visualized as something, some kind of an effect that leads to decrease in the energy. What does it mean? What it means is the following. You have atom 1, atom 2. This has got some energy, this has got some energy. The two put together have certain amount of energy. Okay, say 10 units here, 10 units here, total is 20 units. If the two come closer, the total energy now becomes less than 20, then we say there is a bond formation there. That means essentially a chemical bond is nothing but some kind of an effect that leads to a decrease in the energy of the system. System means the two atoms which are combining here. Okay, let's move further. And then, as I mentioned earlier also in the introduction part here, that means there are different kind of theories which have come as a matter of, chronologically speaking, certain theories came initially, then there were certain drawbacks to that, then it keeps on improving. It kept on improving, and now we've got a number of theories to discuss about here. But broadly speaking, the theories of chemical bonding can be put into two different classes. One are classical theories, that is, the ones which do not take into account the quantum and mechanical nature of atoms. We know that atoms, we have different models of atoms we have learned about, say Rutherford model, Bohr model, and so on and so forth. We will talk about that some other time. But for right now, basically, the classical theories are the ones which do not consider or do not take into account the quantum behavior of atoms. And the two theories which belong to this category happen to be the causal theory and the Lewis-Langmuir theory, Langmuir-Lewis theory, both ways it goes there. And that is what we are going to talk about today. But just for sake of it, we should also know there are two theories which are so-called called as modern theories, which are based on the quantum behavior of atoms. And they happen to be the valence bond theory and the molecular orbital theory, which we'll be taking up in later sessions over there. But today, we're going to focus attention only on the classical theories, that is the causal theory and the Langmuir-Lewis theory there. Okay, now, actually these two theories which I'm going to now talk about, the classical theory, so to say, the causal theory and Lewis theory, both of them came almost simultaneously in 1916. And they had the basic premise of these two theories was there, that the bond formation is by acquiring stable electronic configuration. Let's understand the meaning of this. There are atoms there, atom 1, atom 2. They have got certain electronic configuration there. they may be stable, may be unstable. But if it so happens, then that when the two combine, if they acquire a stable electron configuration, then we say the bonding is going to form, going to happen between the two atoms there. And the basic premise, the basic assumptions of these two theories was that the electronic configuration of the noble gases is most stable. We know that pretty well. That's one. And secondly, atoms combine in such a way so as to attain this kind of stable configuration. That means an atom may not have it, has a configuration which is not stable, but if it can bind to something else, and if this configuration becomes stable, the atom will tend to bind. So that is the basic meaning of this statement over there. And if you look at, from this perspective, if you look at the first theory first, the Kossoff's theory, which we now call it as ionic bonding, basically Kossoff's proposed that the noble gas configuration is attained by gain or loss of electrons. Basically, if you remember, just mentioned, that is the basic premise of this classical theory is that is the atoms will combine to acquire stable noble gas kind of configuration. And these two theories, the Kossoff's theory and Lewis theory, they just differ in the way this happens there. According to Kossoff, the noble gas configuration is attained by gain or loss of electrons. What basically happens is, that is, the formation of bond involves transfer of electrons. That means a given atom transfers its electron to another atom. So there's a loss of electron from some atom, there's a gain of electron by some other atom there. And this gives you a bond which is called as an ionic bond over there. Let's try to understand it with the help of an example here. If you look at the formation of sodium chloride, well, it was the most common example to quote over here. If you look at sodium atom has electron configuration 2, 8, 1. This is 2, 8, and 1. That means, and if you look at the noble gas configuration closest to sodium atom happens to be neon. That has a electron configuration of 2, 8. That means if this sodium atom can lose this electron, then it can acquire the configuration of a neon gas over there. Similarly, chlorine atom has got electron configuration of 2, 8, 7. And if this can take up one more electron, it becomes 2, 8, 8. It acquires the configuration of argon, which again is a noble gas. That means what we see from here is, that is, this atom, that is sodium atom, can become stable by losing an electron, whereas a chlorine atom can become stable by gaining an electron. And that is what exactly is proposed by Kossoff. That is, there is in the formation of sodium chloride, there is a transfer of electron from sodium atom to chlorine atom there. So what happens as a consequence of that? What happens is the following. That is, this sodium atom now, since it has lost an electron, so what happens is, initially here, there were 11 protons and 11 electrons outside there. So atom was neutral. But since it has lost one electron, but the nuclear charge happens to be still 11, there are 11 protons, but there are 10 electrons outside there. So there is a positive charge on this. I mean, this becomes a ion now, sodium ion, a cation. Similarly, the chlorine atom, which had a electron configuration of 287, that picks up that electron. So now there are 18 electrons outside there, and there are 17 protons. There is an excess of a negative charge there. So this becomes a negative charge ion. We call it as a chloride ion there. Okay, so that's first step. That means sodium atom has lost an electron or transferred its electron to chlorine atom, and the two have become ions. One has become a positive ion, that's a cation, and one has become a negative ion, that is an anion there. What happens next? What happens next is this cation and this anion, since they are electrically charged now, one is positively charged, one is negatively charged, the two will attract each other. So that is what exactly is the electrostatic interaction comes into play. When the two combine like this, so what you get is a system of this kind, what's called as a sodium chloride. And sodium chloride, actually, it's not that there's only one sodium comes and one chlorine comes, one sodium ion comes, one chloride ion comes, and becomes a one NaCl. It doesn't happen that way, because there are large number of sodium ions, there are large number of chloride ions, they all will combine to make a lattice of sodium chloride, which I'm sure that you learned at your school. That is how sodium chloride lattice looks like. That means for each sodium ion, there are six chloride ions around that in octahedral fashion, and similarly around every chloride ion, there are six sodium ions in octahedral fashion there. And that is how the structure of NaCl, that is how the NaCl crystal, a big crystal of NaCl looks like. Okay, so that is about Kossoff's theory. That means essentially, if you try to kind of interpret from here, what you see is that the ionic bond is nothing but the electrostatic force that holds ions together in an ionic compound. So, if anybody asks what exactly is an ionic bond, it's nothing but that is the electrostatic force by which the two ions, which are formed as a consequence of transfer of electrons, they hold each other. Okay, so that is what is called as an ionic bond. Okay. Now let's take one more example here. Say formation of magnesium oxide. So in case of magnesium oxide, what happens is magnesium has got two electrons outside, the valence electrons there. 2A2 is the electron configuration there, and oxygen has got 2-6, 2 in the inner core, and there are 6 valence electrons there. If magnesium can lose these 2 electrons, this becomes again 2-8 neon. And if oxygen takes up these 2 electrons, which exactly happens over here, this also becomes a neon atom there, equivalent of neon configuration there. So essentially, the 2 electrons are lost by magnesium to become magnesium cation. And 2 electrons are now gained by these are so-called hollow ones there, which are gained by oxygen atom to become an oxide ion there. That is how magnesium oxide is formed. Similarly, you can think of formation of calcium fluoride there. Calcium ion again, similar to magnesium, it also has got 2 electrons which are given to an electron each to one of the fluorine atoms over there. So as a consequence, what you get is a formation of calcium fluoride there. So there are different examples here. That's fairly good as regards the simple compound formation goes in case of ionic systems there. But there is certain limitation to this. There's a very simple theory as such. There's just a transfer of electrons and the two atoms become stable and they combine together electrostatically. But there are certain limitations to that. And the limitation happens to be if you look into, say, bonding in case of oxygen molecule. So what do we find? What you find is that in case of oxygen molecule, the formation of bond can be seen as that there are two oxygen atoms there. So it has electron configuration of 2-6. There are 6 valence electrons here. Similarly, there are also 6 valence electrons there. Okay. So what can happen? The oxygen atom number 1 can give these 2 electrons to atom number 2. And what you get is there is a cation formation, there's an anion formation, and the two can combine together. So that is the way we can visualize bond formation in case of oxygen in terms of Kossel's theory. But there's a question there. That's a very simplistic way. But there is no rationale to believe that there is between the two atoms, which are identical, both oxygen atoms are identical. So how does it happen that one loses 2 electrons and one gains 2 electrons? That is slightly ambiguous. So that means, in other words, we can say the Kossel's theory is not able to explain the bonding in oxygen molecule. That means the formation of O2 from 2 oxygen atoms is not explainable in terms of Kossel's theory. That's the simplest, or even say, a very, very fundamental limitation of Kossel's theory. Okay, let's move ahead and talk about one more limitation here. That is, suppose look at the bonding in case of lithium oxide. This, the 2 atoms of lithium and 1 of oxygen, and they can form 2 lithium ions there and 1 oxide ion there. And question comes is, then how do they crystallize? In case of NaCl, we could visualize, okay, there's 1-to-1 correspondence there. So in case of this lithium oxide, we really do not know what kind of crystal formation will be there, what will be stoichiometry and things like that. So that is, again, that means what we can say is the Kossel's theory talks about bond formation in terms of transfer of electrons, number 1. Number 2, it is able to explain bond formation in number of ionic compounds, but is not able to tell bond formation in case of oxygen molecule. And also, in examples like lithium oxide, we see that it doesn't tell how does it crystallize, that means what kind of crystal is formed over there. That doesn't come from the theory here. Okay, let's move ahead. Let's move ahead and talk about the second theory, that is Lewis theory. Basically, that concerns the covalent bond formation there. Again, since this also is a classical theory, because we're not talking about orbital at all, because according to quantum mechanical dimensions, quantum mechanical aspect of an atom, we know that atom has got, there's a nucleus and there are different orbitals around that. We haven't talked anything about orbitals as such. We're just talking about atom as probably described by Rutherford, followed by Bohr. So there is a nucleus and there are electrons outside in different orbits over there. Okay, now going further, basically one more thing I'll try to recall for you, that is, when talking about classical theories, we said there are two basic assumptions. One, that is, the noble gas configuration is highly stable, number one. Number two, that is, the atoms combine in such a fashion that they try to acquire noble gas configuration. So that is a motivation for the two to combine together. And Kossel said that this acquiring noble gas configuration happens by transfer of electrons. Lewis proposed a different mechanism for that. And the mechanism happens to be, that is, the noble gas configuration is attained by sharing of a pair of electrons. That means the two atoms, they share an electron each. There's no transfer. Okay? So that means both, because any bond formation means there have to be two electrons there. There has to be electron pair. So for that pair to be formed, both the atoms which are going to combine, they contribute one electron each, and that becomes a pair, and that is the one which holds the two atoms together. And this shared pair of electrons stabilizes both the bonding atoms. We'll see with the help of examples here. And this kind of bonding is called as covalent bond. So what Kossel proposed, by transfer of electrons, we are having ionic bond formation. And so Lewis' theory, there is a sharing of electrons that leads to covalent bonding, as you know it. Okay, let's have a look at this. This basically is just trying to talk about formation of a molecule of hydrogen. So this is an atom of hydrogen with one electron there. Though I had attempted to use some kind of picture which looks like an orbital one, but take it to be just that. There is a hydrogen atom there, there is a nucleus of hydrogen atom, there is one electron there. Because this was a little easy to visualize, so that I put it over here. But please don't get confused about it. I'm not talking about the quantum mechanical theories as yet, because this picture will be more relevant when we talk about valence bond theory, which we'll talk at a later stage. But for right now, what we can visualize like this, I mean, there is one hydrogen atom here, okay, atom one. Another hydrogen atom here, atom two. This has one, there's a nucleus here, there's one electron. Similarly, nucleus here, one electron there. The two are far apart, the energy is very low. As they come closer and closer, energy decreases. When they come fairly close, so this one electron of this atom and this one electron of this atom, the two come together and they form what's called as an electron pair. So when they form an electron pair, what happens now? This electron pair now belongs to this hydrogen atom as well as to this one. So this hydrogen atom will now have a configuration of 1s2. Similarly, for this also, since there are two electrons which are now shared ones, this also becomes 1s2. So both of them acquire the helium configuration. Both of them become stable. Okay, so that is the way we can visualize the bond formation in case of Lewis theory. That means the two atoms come together, share their electron, and form a bond. This bond pair now, the electron pair now, belongs to both the atoms there. Let's look at some examples more. Say here, so hydrogen atom, this is one electron here, this is one electron here, the two combine together, so this becomes a lone electron pair. Now this electron pair now belongs to this as well as to this. So that means if I look at this electron pair as a part of this hydrogen atom, so there are two electrons, this becomes stable helium configuration. Similarly, if I allocate these two electrons to this hydrogen atom, this also becomes stable there. So that is how the stability was acquired by the two atoms which are combining there by this shared pair of electrons. Let's take more examples here. Look at formation of, say, fluorine molecule. In case of fluorine, what do we have? So there are seven valence electrons there. Similarly, here also there are seven valence electrons. The two come together, come close to each other, and this electron and this electron, they share up. And they form an electron pair over here. And now this electron pair actually holds both of these atoms together. And also, if you look at this electron pair with this fluorine, so this becomes 8 electrons. So this is stable, neon configuration. Similarly, here also, this also becomes stable there. So that is the way we visualize formation of a bond according to Lewis theory. Let's take one more example here. So that is how we represent it. So this single electron pair which is bonding the two atoms together is shown by some kind of a line. And this line we are familiar with as a bond. Let's take one more example, say formation of carbon dioxide. In case of carbon dioxide, what do we have? This oxygen atom, this carbon, this is another oxygen there. Oxygen has got 6 valence electrons, carbon has got 4, 2 here, 2 here, and this oxygen has also got 6 of them there. And when the two combine, that these 3 atoms combine together, what do we get? So this carbon atom shares 2 electrons, this also gives you 2 electrons there. So there are 2 electron pairs. Okay, so if there are 1, 2, 3, there are 4 electrons here, 2, 6 and 2, 8. So this oxygen becomes having 8 electrons, becomes stable. Similarly, look at this carbon, there are 4 electrons here, 4 electrons here, and this again becomes 8, becomes stable. Similarly, this atom of oxygen, there are 2 plus 2, 4 and 4, 8 electrons, this also becomes stable. That means all the 3 atoms become stable. Further, what we have to see here is, since there are now 2 electron pairs which are shared there, they form what's called as a double bond. That means this carbon atom is attached to two oxygen, bonded to two oxygens in terms of 2 double bonds there. Okay, let's look at formation of say HCN and acetylene. In case of HCN, what you have is the following. So there is formation of a triple bond over here. Similarly, here also there is a formation of a triple bond there. Okay, so and that is how do we represent that? This is a single bond here and triple bond here. In case of acetylene, there is a CC triple bond and then CH-CH single bonds over there. So that is how we can visualize bond formation according to the Lewis theory. Essentially, there is a sharing of electrons by the contributing atoms which are going to combine there. Okay, I think we are back. We will see how to handle this hiccup here. So what basically we have is, say if I'm looking at bonding in water molecule, what do I find is that I can describe the bond formation between oxygen, essentially they got 6 electrons, shares 1 electron each with the 2 hydrogen atoms which have got 1 electron each, and they form 2 single bonds over there. But the question is, what is the shape of water molecule? This again, there's no clue about the shape of molecule in case of say water or any other molecule for the matter. That means Lewis theory tells you the formation of bond but doesn't tell anything about the shape of the molecule which is formed as a consequence of covalent bonding there. Similarly, if you remember, we just talked about Cotrel's theory. We did know how an ionic bond is formed. Yes, we know that. There is a transfer of electrons, we can form a bond. But what happens after that? How does the crystal formation take place? There is no clue about it. That means, what will be the nature of crystal formation, or what will be the nature in which ions formed over there will combine together. So there again, we find that there is some kind of a limitation, even in case of Lewis theory. That is why there was a need to go for modern theories, the quantum mechanical theories. We'll talk about those theories in a later sessions over there. But for right now, it will be worthwhile to talk about when Lewis talked about this bond formation. He actually visualized initially bond formation in terms of cubes. That means he visualized atoms as it should not be 1802, it should be 1902. There is an error over here. So he visualized atoms as cubes. Now, what do you mean by that? He visualized something of this kind. He visualized that, say, a hydrogen atom or a lithium atom can be seen as a cube. This cube, you can get a cube, a cube has got 8 corners. So we're talking something like octet here. So since in case of hydrogen atom, there's only 1 valence electron, so this is the electron shown over there, and rest is, there's a nucleus and the inner electrons are there. So for lithium, there'll be 2 electrons inside. For hydrogen, there's no inner electron, there's only 1 electron there. Say for helium, there are 2 valence electrons. For boron and aluminium, there are 3 of them, and so on and so forth. So he initially thought in 1902 that atoms can be visualized as cubes and the electrons, the valence electrons, as at the corners of the cubes there. So with that kind of a visualization, he talked about the bond formation by sharing. Let's see how does that happen. He talked about formation of a single bond by sharing of an edge. Say there is one atom here, there is another atom there. Actually, this has been stretched out. This should have been cubical. This has now looks like a more of a cuboid. And but in any case, the concept can still be talked about. So this, let's assume it to be a cube, and there is one electron here. This is another cube. This is one electron which is missing over there. Now this edge of this atom and this edge of this atom, the two can be shared. When the two share, what happens? Now this cube has got two electrons. Say it requires so-called helium gas configuration. This has got eight of them there. Helium are equivalent over there. So similarly, this also becomes stable. So that is how a single bond formation can be seen in terms of sharing of an edge. Double bond formation could be seen as, say, face sharing. This is one cube, this is another cube there. This is one face here, this also has a face. So when the two combine together, then they share the face there. So this becomes eight, this also becomes eight. Both of them become stable and there's a formation of double bond there. But this actually can be seen as the formation of, say, oxygen molecule. If you remember, we just said as a limitation of Kossoff's theory, that Kossoff's theory doesn't explain the formation of oxygen molecule. To that extent, Liouville's theory is better than Kossoff's theory, but because according to this, so essentially we can see that there are two electrons here, these are two electrons. So two electrons of atom number one, two electrons of atom number two, they are shared together. And the sharing actually can be seen in terms of sharing of a phase here. And what you get is both of the atoms become stable. So this is formation of oxygen molecule. But even this doesn't hold for very long, because if we want to talk about formation of, say, a triple bond, this is definitely a limitation of Kossoff's theory has been overcome by this kind of explanation there. But the question comes is, what happens? How do we represent a triple bond? There can be edge sharing, there can be face sharing. There can be many other way of sharing of two cubes. So we cannot represent a triple bond formation according to Liouville's theory. So that's again where Liouville's theory is inadequate. Okay, I think that's all for today. Let's sum up what we have done today. What basically we have done is, we started by introducing the chemical bonding, and we realized that a chemical bond is nothing but a process, any process that can lead to a decrease in the energy of the system. A system here means the two atoms which are combining together. That's one thing we talked about. Thereafter, we shared a few historical thoughts about the nature of chemical bonding. People visualize that some kind of hooks are there, or some kind of magnetic force of interaction and things like that. And thereafter, we discussed about two classical theories of chemical bonding, that is the Kossoff's theory, anionic bond formation, and Liouville's theory, covalent bond formation. And of course, we did realize and kind of outlined the limitations of classical theories. In the next session, we will continue from here and try to introduce the so-called modern theories, and then see how do they account for the inadequacies of classical theories there. Thank you very much.